Hello, everybody. Guess what? We are here. Episode 16. It's so great to be here with you for Fired Up Live. And we have an amazing show ahead of us. So get all ready, comfy. Hope you're in your comfy clothes, hanging out, maybe with your family or your friends tonight. Obviously, just probably had something delicious on the fire disc, right? Or somebody's still cooking for you while you get to hang out and watch. Or it's a hands-free event. You can just prop this thing up and cook all show long. That sounds good to me. Let's do a song. How about that? And I just hope everybody's doing great out there. I've missed you. Make sure you're leaving some comments tonight for a chance to win your very own fire disc cooker. I'm going to do a song of mine called This Story.
All kinds of sweetness and all kinds of crazy. In heaven, my God, there's so many days we go running around with our heads in the clouds. Driving a heart, it's a good place to start the story. In chapter one, it's always good fun. I'm telling my friends that this could be the one. And he opens the door and leaves me with kisses. Before he goes, I'm already missing the story. Writing the words one day at a time. I can't believe that this story's all mine. I wished for a star and I got the whole sky. Fact or fiction, this story's all. In chapter two, is it all about you or all about us? Keeping the trust, will we swear on a diamond? We'll always keep shining. And when we get older, we'll never grow cold in this story. Writing the words one day at a time. I can't believe that this story's all mine. I wished for a star and I got the whole sky. Fact or fiction, this story's all mine. But every story's like this, and in the end, he doesn't exist. Oh, how can I turn this page in the wind? This story's everything. Writing the words one day at a time. I can't believe that this story's all mine. I wished for a star and I got the whole sky. Fact or fiction, this story's all mine. fiction. Well, this story's all mine.
Thanks for listening out there, everybody. Thank you so much. That is technically an unreleased song. Well, you guys have heard me do it for Fired Up Live before, but we don't have a recorded version of that one yet. So if you enjoyed that song, I want you to make sure you let me know. It's always been my dad's favorite, so I know that he's waiting for that one to come out any day now. So what's going on, you guys? I'm just excited to get to our special guest tonight, as well as hear from you and see some of your comments coming in. After this episode, I'll be on there checking them all out and answering you guys. And that's always your chance to win some Heuser Country Blend coffee and a swag pack, a Fire Dis swag pack, and even a cooker. So make sure, don't forget, leave some love on here. Give it a share. Give it a share. Maybe we're going to make that the new thing. You might, you know what? I'm changing it right now. As of tonight, episode 16, you can win a Fire Dis cooker if you share this video. How's that sound? Am I allowed to do that? Can I make some rules? You have the chance to win. The way that you enter to win, either Heuser Country Blend coffee, Fire Dis swag pack, or a Fire Dis cooker, the way that you can get your chance to win is if you share this video. So click it right now. You can do it right now. Because you're busy filming. You can't share it right now like they can. So yeah, Tony's out of it, out of the loop. You've already got one. Okay, you guys. All right, let me compose myself here because, okay, I got my hair. I'm going to put my ears in. 1 second. It's about to get good. Okay, Fire Dis Nation, I have such a special guest for you today that I am personally so excited about because this is one of my favorite voices and writers that I've come across in a long time, and I'm excited to share her with you. Some of you probably follow her already. She is a multi-award-winning Virginia native and a singer-songwriter who's now based in Nashville. She's won many awards from industry mainstays like the Kerrville Folk Festival, and she's been mentioned by some of my other favorite artists that I want to get to talking with her in a second. So let's bring a very warm welcome. Everybody, comment away for my special guest today, Caroline Spence. Hey, Caroline.
Hi.
How are you doing?
I'm doing well. How are you?
I am great. And I'm so excited. I like hunted you down a long time ago and was like, I need you to come on this show. And I'm so happy we finally made it happen. So what is going
Likewise.
On with you? What have you been up to? We're going to get into all of your good stuff, but what are you doing right now?
Right now, my life feels like I'm a full-time gardener with a song habit, but no complaints. Definitely finding the silver lining every day with what we're all going through. But yeah, just thankful for time at home and yeah, time to sort of be creative in a lot of different ways that I don't usually get to do when I'm on the road all the time. So it's
been
great.
Right. Well, full-time gardener sounds pretty peaceful. And yeah. that allows you that time to write that you're right. When we're out on the road like crazy people, it's like that time just slips away. And, you know, you're taking a little voice memo here and there in your phone. But to actually be able to sit down and have that time to just write and be creative, it has been a blessing in disguise out of all this stuff.
Absolutely.
So I came across some of your older songs, some of your second album releases a couple years ago. I think the one that really caught my attention, it was on some Spotify playlist of like rising roots and folk and Americana. And Your Heart of Somebody came on my Spotify, and I just like heard the first line and was like, oh my God, who is this? So that was the one that like had me dive deeper into you. And then I was like, I wonder if she's got anything else, because this is so good. This is right up my alley. What else does she have for us here? And I come across Hotel Amarillo and I'm like, okay, this is it. Adding all the songs to my playlist. Absolutely fell in love with it. So I've been listening to you since then. And in between that album and your last release, something really amazing happened where you signed with Rounder Records.
Yeah, I did. I put out like two albums about as independently as one can do it.
Right.
And then, yeah, put out my third record, Mint Condition, with Rounder Records, which if you told me like the day I moved to Nashville that that would be something that happens to me, I would have not believed you. So it's definitely a dream come true.
It's absolutely amazing. I mean, you joined label mates. You became official label mates with Rustin Kelly, Billy Strings, Cody Jenks, Robert Plant, and Allison Krauss. And these are names that like, I mean, what? It's just amazing.
Allison Krauss was one where I was like, one of the first couple songs I learned on guitar were a few of hers. So right. That was sort of like a pinch me thing for me, for sure.
It's absolutely amazing. And then so after this album with Heart of Somebody and Hotel Amarillo, and that's where I really got a good feel for your sound. And then was so excited about this new release, Mint Condition, that you put out with Rounder. And something that as a listener, I felt your sound almost just blossomed more. But when you went into this whole new album with Rounder Records, were you looking for a way to switch up your sound, or were you really just trying to put more of what you had already brought to the table out there?
Well, I'd actually already made the record before I signed. So
amazing.
That was, that felt really good to me, because whoever I was going to partner with had to sort of meet me where I was.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, I don't think I was really going for any sort of new direction. I think with each new batch of songs, you sort of have to follow where the songs need to go. And mm-hmm. I'm much more comfortable with the role of like songwriter than artist still to this day. But so I think that one does feel a little more like true kind of like roots rock in the songwriting. And so that's sort of, we were just trying to be true to where the songs were pointing and sort of like hone in on maybe what the influences were and chasing those rabbit holes. So yeah.
Right. Well, I love that they just like met you. And I was reading how it seemed that they just like completely understood your heart and your vision. It's amazing the way it came across in this album. So tell me about the song Long Haul from the new record.
Yeah. So that one, that's about what we do, which is work a little too hard, too long, travel too far for not enough money, like all the stuff that we just sort of do in the name of what we love. And that was sort of a anthem I almost wrote for myself on a night or day when I wasn't where I wanted to be, but I knew like if I just put my head down and kept going, I might get there. And so that's the thing, like the way I always sort of thought of myself as an artist was someone who was in it for the long haul. I'm not trying to be a flash in the pan. I would really love to have a long career. And if that means just like a slow burn to be able to do this, that's what I want. So I tried to put that in that song and then make it kind of something fun you could sing along to. Cause I love to do the like kind of fun song that it's a little bit sad. It's one of those.
I love it. And it definitely is. It's like my mouth was open listening to it the whole time. Like, oh my God, it's so true. It's almost like a modern take on Turn the Page. a little bit. Just that, sure, like,
yeah.
I'm out there, I'm doing it. What am I doing? I don't know. Am I crazy? I don't know, but I'm going to keep doing it. And definitely, yeah, as musicians, exactly. That's something, an artist, that's what we go through. But I think even people that aren't in this industry could put themselves in those shoes about whatever they're doing, because it's just something everybody feels sometimes, that we're just overdoing it. But what are we going to do? Keep going, because we're in it for the long haul. It's just such a good message.
Exactly.
So great.
Well, thanks.
Oh my goodness. Okay. So that was a definite personal favorite for me, Long Haul. And the other was Sit Here and Love Me. Mm-hmm. When did you write this one? Was this like something that you brought out from way back, or did you write this specifically for the third album?
I don't really write like for albums. I sort of like be like, oh, I think I have enough that I really like. What have I made? And mm-hmm. then sort of see what's speaking the strongest. But that one, I can't remember when I wrote it in relation to the album. It wouldn't have been that, you know, it was a newer one. But it was one I hesitated to put on the record, mm-hmm. honestly, because it did feel so personal. I think all of my songs are personal in that I try to like put myself in them and like, you know, make them true. But mm-hmm. whether they're like fully my story isn't always the case. But that one was very much my story. And because it felt so personal, I think I doubted that it also was universal. And I think that's the thing I know as a writer, is the more that you really share of yourself, the more you are going to find that you're connecting with other people who think it's their story too. So I'm really glad I was pushed to put that one out, because I think there are a lot of people that struggle to articulate, you know, their feelings when they're going through bouts of depression and anxiety, especially when you're in a partnership where the other person maybe isn't on the same page. So that's what that song is about for me. Mm-hmm. And it's a hard one. It was a hard one to sing every night on the road, but it was worth it every time someone came up at the merch table and was like, this helped me talk to my daughter who I don't know how, you know, that kind of thing. Yeah. And I've like cried at the merch table with people about it, just because it's like, it's just as special to me to hear that I'm not alone as it is for them to hear through that song that they're not alone. So I just love songs.
I know.
I love songs, and that they can do that for all of us.
And isn't it so funny how there's these songs that are so personal to you, or, you know, the writer, and those are the ones sometimes that you really need the push from other people to put out. And I had the same situation happen with, I just released an album, and I had this one song that we'd been sitting on for a few years. And I kind of thought, you know, it was one of those same things where it's just so personal and kind of sad and kind of slow. And I didn't think that it would be one that everybody gravitated towards at all. I thought, okay, if it makes the album, it'll be a deeper cut that eventually people will get to and like, but right off the bat, no way. And it was really my sister who was like, you need to finish that song. That is the one that everyone's going to like. Everyone's been through that heartbreak. Like, you just have to trust that and do it. And so finally we reworked it in the studio and brought it to life. And now it's been the one that everyone has listened to by far. It's going to be the next single. And it's just crazy how...
That's amazing.
It's crazy how we... like love our songs so much and have so much faith in them, but the ones that are closest to us sometimes are the ones that you need the push for.
Absolutely. Yeah.
So do you think you could play one for us today for Fire Destination?
Sure. Everyone's
waiting for it.
Yeah, I'll play Long Haul today.
Oh my God.
I didn't know that was a favorite of yours.
Yes, I would love that.
That one feels good. Oh yeah, I'll play that one for you.
Perfect. That sounds so great. All right, everybody, you're going to love this. It's called Long Haul.
Expecting something.
Gosh, that was so beautiful. Thank you so much for playing that song. It really means so much. Just
of course
listening to that from our point of view, I just loved it. And that guitar is absolutely gorgeous.
Thank you. She's an old gal, but she does me right.
Oh my God, it's so pretty. It's so pretty. Do you write?
I need to take her to the shop.
Really? She needs some trusty dusty work?
Yeah, I was like, oh, yeah, she hasn't been on the road in a while. You got to keep them tuned up. And I'm like, they've just been sitting here on vacation on my wall. I need to take care of them.
Oh, my gosh. Yeah, I know. You want to just think that letting them sit and breathe is going to be the right thing for it. But sometimes the old ones can be a little high maintenance. We've learned a thing or two about that. Okay, <Yeah. laughs> Do you have your coffee in hand?
I do. Yes. I have my coffee.
We've got a coffee drinker, everybody. Good.
Oh, yeah.
I want to talk to you a little bit about writing, because I know that you said you're more comfortable like as a writer than a performer. But did they always kind of go hand in hand for you? Did you ever think that you would just be writing?
That's what I moved to Nashville to do. I wanted to be like a behind the scenes. I wanted to like write for Miranda Lambert. And so like I just wanted to get a pub deal. And so I felt like, you know, the only way to get out there is to play your songs. Mm-hmm. And yeah, I always sang in like, you know, my young life. And at college and stuff, and but I didn't know like my voice was anything unique. Like I knew it was good, but I just didn't know it was a thing. So that is, you know, a lot of times people move to Nashville and get their ass kicked, and I was like, oh shit, am I a good singer? This is not what I expected to learn here, but that's kind of what I did. So that built some confidence, and then I really kind of fell in love with performing too. And so I love performing. I think it's just the like capital A artist thing where I'm like, I'm not a brand. I'm just a little person that likes to, you know, sing songs and write them. But yeah, I do love performing because I really singing, I'm sure you feel the same way, but singing is like such a joyful thing
It is,
to do. And
absolutely.
I always tell people, even if they can't, they say they can't sing. I'm like, well, you should sing because it feels good, you know?
Exactly. And you never know what
Yeah.
someone is going to think is that unique sound or that. It took me hearing it
Yeah.
from my manager. He's like, I don't know what your voice is, but it's got a fingerprint and we're going to figure it out. And
Yeah.
so,
Oh,
it took
yeah. I
working
love
that.
that.
I wanted to sing like huge songs, Carrie Underwood, Adele, and I'm like, I don't have that type of voice. So it took kind of crafting what you do have and what you can work with. And yeah, definitely getting to go out and do that is something I couldn't live without. But then I feel the same way sometimes about writing. It's like, could I do it if I was really just singing somebody else's song? I don't know. But I love
Yeah,
that one
I
of your
think it.
goals was to write for Miranda because she's my absolute favorite. And I know that
She's awesome.
she kind of recognized that you're really great too, and might have mentioned you on social media.
That was absolutely insane. I'd put out one record, I had like 500 followers or whatever. And she posted about this record and this one particular song, and it was like it had been a big snow in Nashville, and I'd been snowed in, and I hadn't been able to charge my phone or like take a shower because the power was out. Finally got to plug in my phone, took a shower, got out, and I picked it up, and it was like scrolls and scrolls and scrolls of notifications, and I was like, what's going on?
Oh
And I got on
my
my phone
God.
and realized that is what had happened, and she'd been snowed in, I found out, and had been just like stuck in her house listening to my record, and I was like, what the is this world?
Oh my
So,
gosh, it's
I
amazing.
mean, that gave me such a boost of confidence, just the like the one of the people that I respect the most, that you know, that I wanted to write for, recognize what I was doing. I was just like, cool. On my bad days, I'm like, yeah, okay, this like manager doesn't want to work with me. Miranda Lambert d thinks I don't suck. Like, it's fine. It's gonna
Oh
be
my
fine.
gosh, it's the
So
greatest thing ever.
it really, I really do wonder like where I would be or how it, you know, that kind of thing without that little boost of confidence. It was such a gift to me early on, you know. Yeah.
That's amazing. And actually, as you were telling this story, I just remembered something that I know that you came across my playlist on Spotify, but I also think another reason why I started checking you out was because Tyler Childers mentioned you.
Yeah.
Did you see that on Instagram?
Oh
I'm
yeah,
pretty
he
sure he shared your album cover and was like, this girl is amazing or something. And I'm like, okay,
Yeah,
wait,
I would
I've
say
seen this name. So that is so cool. And just to be like recognized by other people in the industry that are taken so seriously. And oh my God, it's just so
yeah.
cool. So cool to see.
No, it's great. Tyler and I met at an open mic
Oh
in
my God.
2013. Yeah.
Nice.
And the first song I ever heard him play was White House Road. And I was like, what the actual? I mean, yeah,
That's
he's amazing. So it's been
awesome.
like so cool to see him get that recognition because like he's genuinely always been that good.
Yeah,
So,
exactly. I'm like, well, I discovered
yeah.
him and I thought I was like the first one. And then I look him up. I'm like, okay, he's playing at the Opry. He's been singing White House Road for like 10 years, but now everybody's just finally
Yeah.
recognizing it. And it's so good to see that.
Yeah.
Oh my gosh. So, yeah, I'll share you my cool news because I don't get to say this for very much longer. But I found out I'm going to be opening for Miranda in September. And so she's like,
that's so fun.
To hear the Miranda stories gives me goosebumps because that's how much I love her too. And that's just, I think that's the coolest thing.
Where are you opening? What city?
It's in Niagara Falls. So it's at a casino. Ooh, here. We're in Western New York, so not far from here. And she's coming to town.
That's awesome.
So, yeah. Yeah. I want to talk to you about one of your songs that I think was inspired by your grandmother. Mm-hmm. Mint Condition, the title track of this past album. I want you to explain this, but you had a little certain somebody in mind, speaking of idols and people we look up to. You had somebody in mind for this one when you were writing.
Yeah, this interview is really reminding me just like how lucky I've been, genuinely. I'm like, okay, things have been pretty good for me. But
they have. Looking through your story, I'm like, God, she's good enough. But then you look at all the things you've actually done and accomplished and people that have recognized it. And it's just like so awesome.
Yeah, it's, you know, it's just so funny with not being on the road and feeling, you know, taking some time. This is like, I'm feeling gratitude right now. But Mint Condition, I wrote a while ago, like earlier on in my time in Nashville, and wrote it from, or tried to write from the point of view of my grandmother, singing about her long life with my grandfather, and then also sort of her life after he passed. So just like, I don't know why, as at 23, I was like trying to write like that, but I was. And sort of the prompt I gave myself was to write something that, like, I was imagining Emmylou Harris's voice when I was writing it. I'd been really into this Old Yellow Moon album that she'd just put out with Rodney Crowell, and everything was just so classic and beautiful. And I was sort of chasing that. And, you know, even when I played the song early on, I would be like, well, just imagine that I have Emmylou Harris hair and I'm wise beyond my years and like blah, 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 because I'm too young to be singing this song. But so fast forward and we're making Mint Condition, and I was working, Dan Nobler was the producer, and he had a relationship with her from previous projects. And I am not one to like, I'm like a very afraid to ask for things. It's like a problem in my life. I'm like really bad at asking for help, that sort of thing. But it was just one of those things, once I realized it was within reach to potentially have her on this song, I was just like, this is genuinely a dream come true. And somehow she said yes to sing on my little record that didn't have a release date or a partner or anything. And so to hear her voice singing on that song, like the version that's on the album is so close to what was in my head the night I wrote it, you know, except it's the only so difference beautiful. Was that she was singing lead. I would rather have her sing lead and I could do harmony, but
you have Emmylou Harris backing you up. I mean, can you even believe that? It's amazing.
No, it's absolutely insane. And it's truly such a gift as a writer to have that, you know, to see it from point A to point B, mm-hmm. and have it just come out exactly how you dreamt it. Yeah.
Absolutely amazing. And Emmylou, you wouldn't believe how many times I actually picture myself with Emmylou hair and just trying to maintain, like, throughout my whole life, if I can maintain a class and style like Emmylou has, she just continues to like get better. And her Wrecking Ball album was introduced to me by my manager. He was like,
that was
something he grew up listening to. And he had me check it all out. And we referenced it all the time when we were coming up with my album, because it was like, she has a little bit of that, well, a lot of that storytelling characterized voice that, it doesn't matter what she says. It just like goes straight to your soul. And so to have her on Mint Condition, I think it just brought that little bit of like that wisdom and, you know, been there, done that feeling, even if we are listening to it in our mid-20s and I don't know. It just brought all of that to it. So it felt so real and so genuine to the song. It's just gorgeous.
Thank you. I agree. She really brings that depth to it that it needed. Yeah.
Did you get to actually work with her in the studio?
I was there.
I was there.
I have no instructions whatsoever. But I was there and got to meet her and speak with her. And yeah, she was so kind. I was so starstruck, but I kept it sort of cool. But I just couldn't believe I was sitting next to her on the studio couch while she was like figuring out the harmonies.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah.
Yeah. The first time she must have sang the line, you must have just been like, wow. Unbelievable.
I was like, well, there it is. Okay.
Okay. Wow. This is really happening. Somebody pinch me. All right, do you want to play one more for us? Get that big, beautiful Gibson back down off the wall.
I will. I will play Mint Condition for y'all because that one always turns.
Oh, my goodness.
Yeah, that one always makes the heart feel good.
Perfect. So this is the title track of your last album that everybody needs to go check out. And this is the song that Emmylou Harris was singing along on. Let's hear it.
Life the way you see ain't no apparition.
okay, I'm just going to be sitting here in awe for the rest of the day. And so is the rest of Fire Dis Nation. You guys, I hope you're commenting out there. Don't forget to leave some comments here for Caroline. Ask her anything you want, and we'll try to make sure we get those questions over. You're on social media and everything, right?
Oh, yeah.
Okay, good. Well, I know that because I follow you, but I'm just trying to make sure everybody else knows that. But I am just blown away. I'm so happy I finally got to talk with you. And I know that you've got some new music you've been working on. So there are things coming up for you. And we're so excited for all of that. Do we have any plans on maybe when this is going to be released? Rough?
I'm hearing probably April or at least springtime next year. Maybe a couple songs come in this winter.
Beautiful. And we have to get you to Western New York for a show so we can actually meet up.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Perfect. Or maybe we'll be down in Nashville again soon. We usually take a couple of trips a year, but it's been a little different in the last couple, as we all know. But we're missing it for sure. So while you're still hanging and we're waiting for you to come here, do you think that you'll be adding anything new to your garden?
Oh, of course.
Of course. And do you actually plant like vegetables, or are we just talking like cute succulents?
Oh no, I'm a big fan of flowers. So I have lots of zinnias and like coneflowers and stuff like that. But we've been growing, I've got a bunch of tomatoes and cucumbers and beans and carrots and all the stuff. I'm turning into my great grandmother over here with my flowers and my vegetables. But yeah, I'm really loving it. I always thought I would enjoy this sort of stuff, but I've never been home long enough to even have a house plant, let mm-hmm. alone a garden. So
yeah.
It's been really nice. I'm already like thinking of touring in the summer next year and being like, oh my gosh, I need to teach my boyfriend how to like prune tomatoes.
How am I gonna trust him to do this? He is never gonna do this right.
Be like, sorry, I have to cancel this tour. My cucumbers are popping off. I need to get to pickling. It's fine.
Oh my god.
Yeah.
I've been trying to keep up with like a basil plant, which is so low maintenance. I mean, I don't think you could kill one if you've tried. And every time I come home, the thing is like totally fried up on my porch, and I'm just like, how? This is the third one I've gone through. And at the studio here, they're everywhere, and it's just flourishing all around. I go home, I'm like, oh God, I'm just not meant for this yet.
It's all trial and error. I feel like it's been a good lesson in like letting go for me, because I can be a bit of a perfectionist, and Mother Nature always knows what she's doing, and you just sort of have to learn from it, which is a good lesson in patience too.
Love that.
I'm trying
to
put
some tips. You need to put some tips for gardening on your Instagram so I can get a grip on this.
Oh yeah. Yeah. Just text me. I'll be like, okay, now just move it to the southern corner of the porch. It'll be fine. Yeah.
And so do your fancy vegetables and cucumbers and everything come with somebody who actually knows what she's doing in the kitchen too? Do you cook at all?
I'm a pretty good cook. I feel like before the pandemic, I would have been like, I'm fine. And now I feel like I'm a good cook. And
that's awesome.
With the fancy vegetables. Yeah. So I want to learn next year, maybe my year of being like full homestead and learning how to like can and preserve and stuff. But it's been fun to cook for myself and not have to eat like, you know, venue bar food and stuff like that for an entire year.
Yes. Okay. Well, since this show is sponsored by a grill company, we're going to have to see some of those little recipes, and we're going to have to get you cooking on one of these things so you can show us what you would do with your Fire Dis cooker. Would you like us to send you a Fire Dis cooker?
Oh my gosh, we actually do not have a grill.
Oh so my God, no way.
Incredible. Well, is that real?
This thing's amazing. It just like heats up so fast, and it's like a big wok, so you can do like all your veggies and everything. And
that's amazing. You know,
meats and steaks and chicken and whatever. I don't know if you're vegetarian.
Wow.
But yeah, it's delicious. What'd you say,
Tony? That would be incredible.
Yeah, send us your address. We'd love to get you on and maybe take a picture with it or something and show us what you're making.
Yeah.
Very cool.
That's amazing.
Awesome.
Thank you.
Well, thank you so much for coming on Fired Up Live today. And I've just been dying to get you on here. I was so excited to talk to like such a true, genuine artist and writer. And thank you so much for sharing everything with us today.
Thank you for inviting me and for such a lovely conversation.
Yeah. Was there anything else you wanted to share with everybody before you go? Even like special talent, something funky about Caroline Spence that we need to know?
Hold on.
Oh my gosh, what? Are you knitting? Oh my God, I like to weave.
No, I wasn't knitting.
I literally weave on my loom.
Okay, I actually have like a tiny baby loom that I bought on Etsy as like a little kit during the pandemic.
Because
I was like, I have all this yarn. Yeah, great.
I'll drive everybody crazy because
keeps me sane.
Yeah, when we're on the road, we're like sitting in the car for 10 hours. So I'm sitting there back there weaving and like cutting yarn. And all of a sudden, some goes flying up through the air in the car with the air conditioning. And everybody's like, Claudia, put the yarn away. What are you doing? I'm like, it's keeping me sane back here.
That's my life, but knitting in the van.
Yep. Yes. Mm-hmm. Knitting in the van.
Great. That's a whole other podcast.
That's a whole other episode. Okay, we're just going to get on here and make some crafts and plant and garden.
Yeah,
and
okay.
And then everyone can, okay, good. Well, thank you so much, Caroline. We'll talk to you soon. And
thank
best
you.
Of luck with the new album coming and everything ahead. And hopefully we can see you sometime. I can't wait to actually hear you in person. This is close enough for now,
Likewise.
But we're going to have to get to a show.
Awesome. Well, thanks.
Cheers. We'll see you soon. Wow, that was amazing. I told you I was excited about having her on the show, and she's just one of those genuine hearts that truly cares about what she's doing and the art that she's making. And that's something that keeps me fired up, seeing that in people and just kind of sticking up for what they believe in. Like, this is what I got. So I'm in it for the long haul. You guys have to check out the recorded version of that song too, but I'm excited she played that one for us tonight. I'm going to do one more to wrap up the show. You make sure tonight you are sharing this video for a chance to win all your prizes. I'm out of coffee. It's horrible. Oh my God. It's like a sin around here. Magic hands. Oh, thank you. Look at this service. This only happens when we're on camera, you know. All right. Well, it's good. I got a minute because I got to tune up, and we all know that's usually a disaster. So. Oh boy. So excited that Caroline Spence weaves. Or no, she knits. So I'm not so weird for weaving. How funny. I'm going to do a song that came out on my brand new album. Who's checked it out? Have you been doing your homework? I hope you guys have listened to it at least once. Maybe a bunch of times. That's even better. This is, I always say they're a favorite. I love them all. But to be honest, the day we sat down to write this song, I didn't feel like writing a song. We were getting ready for a big show in New York City. Our very, very first one. Pull these out to here. We're getting ready for our first show headlining in New York City. And, Tony, thank you very much for the coffee. Tony's my co-writer, as a lot of you guys know. And he said, I don't think you have the right song to start your show in New York. I'm like, we have over 200 songs. What do you mean we don't have the right song to start the show? It's like, you need that opener song that just, you know, gets everybody, perks everybody's ears up and gets them ready to listen for a night of you. I'm like, I've done so many shows. We don't have that song yet. What are you talking about? Are you crazy? But I'm like, all right, we need to get ready for this show and we need to put together a set list. So we'll give it like an hour. We'll try to come up with something. If we don't come up with anything, let's just go with something that we know and we love and we feel comfortable with and blah, blah, blah. So we take our little coffees outside and we're like sitting out. There's like a stream in the backyard of the studio here and we're sitting next to the stream. And we kind of just came up with this one. So I'm really glad that I went out to write that day. And sometimes you just have to push yourself, and that creativity is ready to come. So this one's called Tried to Try. Never shy, nobody spent time in the cell, but I love outlaw songs and the stories they tell about fixing some badasses, ripping iron on the road when they hit the loose gravel, the best shift up the load. Tried, oh baby, I tried. When I'm looking in from the outside, it looks like I'm dying. I've tried, oh baby, I tried. Oh good Lord, I promise, heaven knows I've tried to try. Some loving in a flashback after all. Only dream of spending nights like Bogie and Bacall. I use all my time spreading my wings, but I'm back in my tracks by the time the birds sing it. I'll try. I'm dying. I tried, oh baby, I tried. Oh good Lord, I promise, heaven knows I've tried to try. Ooh, yeah. Thank you so much for tuning in for tonight's episode of Fired Up Live, everybody. I'm your host, Claudia Heuser, and we're switching it up tonight. For your chance to win, you've got to share this video. So I hope you'll do just that, and I will catch you for the next one. You know, it's every second Wednesday of every month, and I'll see you next time. Cheers, everybody. I hope you enjoyed our guest tonight.
In today's world, time with family is more valuable than ever. Meet FireDisc, the original portable propane cooker. It sets up in seconds, fires up fast, and cooks anything you throw at it. Whether it's a quick meal at home or in the great outdoors, FireDisc has you covered. Take your kitchen outside and enjoy everything that makes good food great. FireDisc, cooking at home made easy.
Thank you.